Today, I'll be talking about some preliminary results for a project that we have trying to understand how the uplift of mountains shaped by diversity. And particularly in the neotropics, the uplift of the Andes has had an enormous consequence for how climate is distributed, how environmental conditions are distributed across the continent, but also for how biodiversity is distributed. And the Andes typically is host to some of the highest biodiversity regions in the whole planet for plants and animals. However, the uplift of mountains and more generally the emergence of novel environmental conditions in a region can shape linear diversification and the distribution of species and diversity in multiple ways. On the one hand, the emergence of novel environmental conditions can create opportunities for clades of species that are pre-adapted to these environments to colonize and sort in an ecological fashion across these different environmental conditions. In this scenario, the species that you find in different environments belong to clades that are older than the environmental gradient, and the adaptations necessary to survive these conditions also evolved for the most part before the emergence of the environmental gradient. On the other hand, new environmental conditions can create opportunities for recent adaptive diversification, where clades that were already present in the region or that arrived after the uplift of mountains or their generation of the new environmental conditions have a chance to evolve new adaptations to colonize and survive in these different environments. So we're trying to understand to what degree the uplift of the Andes, particularly of the central Andes that happened during the last 30 million years, shaped the evolution of clades and the distribution of diversity across elevational gradients. And to do this, we're using data from the Madidi project, which has a large network of forest plots that go from the lowland Amazonian forests all the way to the tree line. Using this data, we can characterize the elevational distributions of the species. For example, by connecting the lowest and highest point of distribution for a species, we can create an elevational range. But for our analysis, we're particularly interested on the elevational position, which we characterize using the mean elevation. High values of mean elevation suggest that the species has a distribution concentrated in the highlands. Low values that the species is mainly in the lowlands. Additionally, for each species, we have measured a number of different functional traits, which can potentially represent some of the adaptations necessary to survive in these different environmental conditions. And we used principal component analysis to summarize that, that variation in functional traits into new dimensions of functional trait variation that accounts for correlations between these different traits. So first question that we had was, to what degree the elevational position of a species is accounted for by these functional traits or these potential adaptations. And we find that about 40% of the variation in elevation is explained by functional traits. For example, we found that species in the lowlands typically reflect species that have high specific leaf area, while species in the highlands typically are species with thick leaves that have high dry matter content and also thick barks. We were also particularly interested in the phylogenetic structure or the phylogenetic signal, both in the elevational positions of a species, but also in these potential adaptations. So this figure shows a disparity through time plot for mean elevation, for the elevational position. High values of disparity suggest that species or clades at a specific age have a lot of the variation seen in these traits. So for example, clades would have a lot of variation in the elevational position, while low values of disparity reflect variation that mainly happens from one clade to another. So one individual clade typically has little of the variation in mean elevation. To make sense of these empirical patterns, we compared it to a null model, in this case, a Brownian model of evolution that is bounded, so that the species can evolve their elevational positions, but they cannot have elevational positions below sea level or above the tree line. And when we do this, we see that a lot of the clades that predate the uplift of the Andes, marked by this line here, show less variation within clades that you would expect given this null model, suggesting that clades have constrained elevational distributions. However, when we contrast this with what we see for trait dimensions, here represented by the trait dimension one, it's very different. For trait dimensions, we see that most of the variation happens within clades, and that is consistent across the evolution of the clade, suggesting the opposite pattern. So we find that in terms of elevation, the phylogenetic patterns suggest that potentially clades have constrained evolutions and potentially reflect the colonization of pre-adapted clades to occupy different elevations. But when we look at functional traits, the results are the opposite, and they suggest more that a lot of the diversification that led to these different functional traits happened after the uplift of the Andes and potentially occurs within clades. So each clade has a lot of the variation in functional traits. And we're currently working on the new analysis and further work that will help us clarify these potentially contrasting results.